Some bugs in your code are very straightforward. You try running it, you get a syntax error somewhere, Python tells you exactly where, and you fix it. This is great. It's simple and it's satisfying. Sometimes, though, things crash and the error is just kind of impossible to understand. This happens a lot in machine learning for a few reasons. You're working with these big, weird data structures, you're using these big, complex libraries with a lot of moving parts, and also you're doing a lot of GPU computing, and that, in general, is much more difficult to debug. In Keras, there's the additional problem that your models are often compiled before execution, which is great for performance, but it makes debugging extra difficult as well. So this is going to be a video about what to do when you run into one of those nightmare bugs and you just have no idea where to begin with fixing it. So to give you some intuitions for the most common things that go wrong and cause these weird issues, and show you kind of where to look for the sources of bugs that you encounter, let's use this example script. So I'll show it to you here in two parts. First, we do all our imports, we load a data set, we create a tokenizer, and we tokenize the dataset. Next, we convert our datasets to TensorFlow datasets, so that's tf.data.dataset, and that's so that we can run fit on them. And then we load our model from a pre-trained checkpoint, we compile it, and we fit it with those datasets. So this seems straightforward enough. It's similar to what we've done in the course before, but beware, this is spooky code and hides many dark and mysterious secrets. So what happens when we run it? Well, it's not great. So we get this error message, but you know, what does it mean? We tried to train on our data, but we got no gradient. It's pretty perplexing. I mean, how do we even begin to debug not getting a gradient? So when the error doesn't immediately suggest where the problem is, the best solution is often to walk through things in sequence, making sure at each stage that the outputs look right, that everything looks okay at that point. And of course, that means the place to start is always to check your data. So the best way to make sure that the data you're giving the model is good is to grab a batch from the TF-data dataset that your model is training on. And that's because it's right at the end of the training, the data pipeline. And so that means that if those outputs are good, you're guaranteed that your data pipeline is working well. So we can do that by looping over the dataset for one iteration and then breaking. And that gives us a single batch. So what do we get when we inspect that batch? We'll see that we're not getting any gradient because we're not passing labels to Keras. So our labels are in the batch, but they're a key in the input dictionary, and they're not a separate label as Keras expects. So this is one of the most common issues you'll encounter when training transformers models with TensorFlow. Our models can all compute loss internally, but to use that loss for training, the labels need to be passed in the input dictionary where the model can see them. This internal loss is the loss that we use when we don't specify a loss when we call compile, when we don't specify a loss argument. So Keras, on the other hand, usually expects labels to be passed separately from the input dictionary and not to be visible to the model, and loss computations will usually fail if you don't do that. So we need to choose one or the other. Either we use the model's internal loss and we keep the labels where they are, or we keep using Keras losses but we move the labels to the place Keras expects them. So for simplicity here, let's fix this issue by using the model's internal loss. And we do that by removing the loss argument from the call to compile. So what happens if we try training now? So we recompile with that, we call model.fit again, what happens? Well, it does run this time, but now we get a loss of nan. So that's not good. Nan means not a number, and it's not a good loss to have in general. In fact, if we inspect our model now, we'll see that not only are all the outputs nan, all the weights are nan as well as the loss. So once a single nan creeps into your computations, it tends to spread because it propagates from the loss back, and once it's in the loss, it's in the gradient, it gets to the gradient, and then once it's in the gradient, it enters the weight updates, and then all your weight updates end up as nan as well. So nan just completely destroyed our model here. But where did it creep in first? So to find out, we need to go back to a point before the model was destroyed. We need to reinitialize the model and look at the outputs for the very first batch. And when we do that, we see that the nan first appears in the loss, but only in some samples. So you can see this in more detail in the accompanying section of the course notes. I am moving fairly quickly here. But we find that if we look at the labels, the samples with a loss of nan all have a label value of 2. So this gives us a very strong clue. If we check the model with model.config.numlabels, we see that the model thinks there's only 2 labels. But if we see a label value of 2, that means there's at least 3 labels, because of course 0 is a label as well. So we got a loss of nan because we had an impossible label in our dataset. And to fix that, we need to go back and set the model to expect the right number of labels. So we can set numlabels equals 3 when we initialize the model with from pre-trained, and now hopefully we can avoid this issue. So now we think our data is good and our model is good, and so training should work. But if we try running model.fit, we do get a loss, it is a number and it is going down, but it's not going down very quickly. And if we keep running this out, we'll find that it stalls at a fairly high loss value. So what's going on? Well, when things are mostly working, but training is slow or a bit odd, that can often be a good time to look at your optimizer and your training hyperparameters. And this is where I want to mention one of the most common sources of issues when you're working with Keras. You can name things like optimizers with strings. So Keras supports that and it's very convenient. But if you do that, all of the options get silently set to their default values. So we specified our optimizer as Adam, but in the process we invisibly got the default learning rate, which is 1e minus 3 or 10 to the power of minus 3. So this learning rate is way too high for training transformer models. We should go back and specify the learning rate directly, not using a string. So good values here are between 1e minus 5 and 1e minus 4. So let's split the difference and pick 5e minus 5. So if you recompile with that, you'll find that training actually works at last. The loss goes down efficiently and it converges to a lower value. So again, I did go through this quite quickly, and I strongly recommend checking out the course notes to see this in more detail and to experiment with the code yourself and see what the errors look like and how you can approach them. But I hope I've given you here a quick summary of the most common bugs and maybe the most common debugging approaches to dealing with them. So good luck, and remember to take plenty of breaks if your code is giving you a hard time.